I mentioned drinking water systems. This is Toledo, Ohio. That is a microcystis bloom in 2003. The glass of water that you see on the upper right hand is actually what was taken out of that. That's what's being taken in by that drinking water system in 2003. You have several issues associated with that. You have the potential for harmful algal blooms. You also simply have the increased organic material that the plant has to treat and deal with. At a minimum, it's much, much more expensive, and possibly also increased health effects associated with disinfection byproducts and some of the harmful algal bloom neurotoxins. This is Kansas, a different part of the country. This is a public health notice to avoid contact with these reservoirs. They're both used for recreation purposes as well as drinking water purposes. Again, an indication of what an impaired water looks like. Impaired streams in Kansas, again, another example. The stream on the right shows you what you're looking at in terms of increased algal growth. Just examples of what impaired water, when you actually let the nitrogen and phosphorus pollution go too far, what do you get? What do impaired waters look like? And then finally, Wisconsin DNR. This is a lake in Wisconsin. Not every lake in Wisconsin looks like this. Wisconsin's a fabulous state. It's a beautiful state. But the point we're trying to make is that algal blooms are real. If you go to Ohio, for example, and you look at Grand Lake St. Mary's, a very recent example of nitrogen and phosphorus loadings that were not reduced in time, you have equivalent kinds of indication. I actually have an overview that I don't show because for some reason it gets people going. But it's simply a foot in Grand Lake St. Mary. It's pulled out and it shows you all the algae on the foot. Actually, the child is healthy. Nothing's wrong, but that sort of connection of a human foot to the algal growth really does seem to get people's attention, and that's really not my objective this morning. It's simply to show you that the impacts, the impairments are real, they exist, and they are across the country. Downstream waters, I think we tend to focus, as is certainly reasonable, we all do, on near-term impacts, the things that we can control within our immediate sphere of influence. And I think a lot of states have immediate water quality issues that need to be dealt with. But even within a state, there can be downstream impacts. And what you see here is the state of Florida. And this is going in, I believe, to the St. Lucie, St. John's River from Goodbye Creek. And what you're seeing is the nitrogen, phosphorus, the algal growth coming downstream. And the advantage of this picture is it simply lets you see the kinds of strands in the streams and the currents that Florida is currently wrestling with. They, by the way, have a TMDL for the St. John River. And in this particular area, they're working, I think, and taking really impressive steps forward to deal with it. But again, an example of a downstream impact, which is very, very real. So what's the science? What you have in front of you are sort of 9 national blue ribbon studies in the last 5 years that document the environmental extent, the national scope of the degradation, drinking water, and ecological impacts across the country. These studies, plus the literally thousands of peer-reviewed studies and articles that have been written, make a very clear documentation of the nitrogen and phosphorus that we generate in different aspects of our life, the discharge or the runoff of that to drinking, to surface water supplies and groundwater supplies, and the cause and effect that that has in terms of generating the algal blooms, the reduced DO, the drinking water risks that we're facing. Sources, again, I make a point when I talk about sources to put them all up, and I try to put them all up on one page because, in my view, they're all intertwined. It isn't just one group versus another group, but this particular overhead, I think, offers some insights in terms of implications for how we can more effectively partner together. Urban stormwater, 80% of the population on 10% of the land. Take a look at that 130 million population growth we just talked about. It's hard to imagine that urban stormwater runoff of nitrogen and phosphorus will not also be dramatically increasing unless we can figure out more effective ways to manage growth and to manage how we handle stormwater in urban areas. Municipal wastewater treatment treats approximately 18 million tons of human solids annually. What's significant is if you look at wastewater treatment plants across the country, 16,500, 17,000, and you do a poll on the permit limits, 90% of the permit limits do not have nitrogen and phosphorus limits in the permit. EPA does not believe that every single wastewater treatment plant needs a phosphorus or a nitrogen limit. But let me ask you this. If there are no nitrogen and phosphorus limits in those permits, how do the folks managing those systems, how do the engineers, how do the biologists, how do they know what to manage to? How do we begin to create clear objectives toward which we all move as we try to reduce loadings? And that's really the point of this, that it's an opportunity, and it's one that we can explore together. Livestock production activities, again, two messages here. First of all, it's an industry. I have cousins who do farming in Vermont. They have 300 or 400 acres. They often wonder why I work for the federal government, in point of fact, but we're still all family members and we love each other. But the fact of the matter is, I think they're probably contributing a relatively small number of that billion tons of manure that are generated every year. And so when we look at the livestock production industry, it seems to me we have to at least ask ourselves, is there an opportunity to work with that industry to more effectively manage manure generation, fertilizer application, and get greater loadings reductions? And we think the answer to that is emphatically yes. And we're working with USDA, and we're working with ag groups in different states to try to form stronger partnerships in that regard. Agricultural row crops, again, $120 billion industry. Inefficient fertilization utilization. What I mean by inefficient isn't that farmers don't know how to apply it, but then when it actually gets applied, how much is actually taken up into the crops versus how much runs off. And that's sort of a science challenge that I think the ag community actually is working very, very hard on. And finally, air deposition, about 20% of the nitrogen from the Chesapeake and the Gulf. Okay, tools. This chart is simply to show you, at least under the Clean Water Act, what are the tools that we have and how effectively have we utilized them? Well, look at the NPDES permits. I mentioned that a substantial number of NPDES permits do not have nitrogen and phosphorus limits in those permits. I haven't mentioned numeric nutrient criteria, but if you look across the country, only 7 states have numeric nitrogen and phosphorus criteria for classes of water bodies. Another 18 or so states have those numeric criteria for water bodies within the state. And then 25 states have no numeric criteria. 303 assessments and listings. I mentioned at the outset we have those TMDLs. They probably understate the extent of national scope. Well, the way you get a TMDL is you first have to go assess and identify the waters. If half the lakes and streams haven't been assessed, again, probably an underutilized tool. TMDLs themselves, we'll talk about in a second, they're incredibly effective for dealing with known and demonstrated harmful impacts. We looked at some of those impacts. One of the questions we ought to be asking ourselves is, should we, from an economic and cost-effective point of view, be waiting for the impacts before we move to address the concerns? Livestock, we've talked a little bit, and again, some others. So what are the standards? TMDLs, historically, when you talk to water quality professionals across the country, I think there is, and you talk to engineers, there's a strong belief and indeed a tremendous amount of work and accomplishments in developing TMDLs. But perhaps some people don't understand, TMDLs by their very nature are only required where the water has already been impaired. They are not required or called for under the Clean Water Act to protect high-quality water or to protect waters that are already attaining water quality goals. So basically, if you look at it from that perspective, you identify a problem and you fix it. I think most engineers and most managers would agree that restoration is inevitably far, far more expensive than prevention. The Chesapeake Bay is a wonderful example of that. $20 billion to date, another $10 billion to go. They're making incredible progress. But there certainly are more cost-effective strategies where the water has not yet been impaired. Permit limits without numeric expectations. It's very, very tough to manage any kind of a treatment facility. Hard to manage without clear targets. Priority BMPs and priority watersheds, increasingly I think we're getting a consensus that there is a subset of BMPs that are both cost-effective and they're very, very strategically appropriate for watersheds where you know you have high loadings and you can go and identify the particular land uses and then you can work and support the farmers to get those BMPs put into place. And finally, nutrient criteria. Historically, the nutrient criteria in this country have been narratives, which is basically it's the equivalent of a free from, no toxic and toxic amounts. Or in the case of nutrients, you have to have a balanced flora and fauna. Again, the challenge with those criteria, if we're trying to together work toward a common goal, is they don't give clear, measurable objectives. They don't allow people to partner with one another. Also, without those numeric criteria, it's very tough to partner between point sources in a watershed and non-point sources in a watershed because you don't have a common baseline against which to measure. One of the conversations I think we're increasingly having on the numeric side is whether we have causal versus response variables. We can talk about that a little bit later. But again, when it comes down to a particular facility, nitrogen and phosphorus parameters do tend to be the easiest to manage and understand what your obligations are. So larger context, what's behind all this? EPA has a petition from the Natural Resources Defense Council to redefine secondary treatment. I think most people would agree secondary treatment for wastewater treatment systems is probably not an effective treatment train to get nitrogen and phosphorus pollutions. The great challenge is, then what is the next step? Is it biological nutrient removal? Is it advanced biological nutrient removal? Is it something else? And we'll talk a little bit about that in a moment. We have lawsuits in Florida, lawsuits in Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Kansas, Missouri. My point to us is that as we look together as a group and we work together, the public expectations around our collective ability to get nutrient loading reductions is increasing. It is not decreasing. Summary, dramatic escalation of nitrogen and phosphorus pollution in the last 50 years, and it's very likely to accelerate unless we change our fundamental approach and strategy for addressing it. Drinking water and aquatic degradation is well documented scientifically on a national basis and a local basis. We need room to innovate and respond to local water quality needs, and I think there is a lot of possibility and potential in this particular area. In particular states, what are the most effective strategies and how best to move forward? Available tools and technologies are well understood. They're not well utilized. Without clear goals, it's extremely difficult to imagine we can make greater progress together. And broader collaboration is not only essential, it's possible, and it probably is the only effective path forward. So in terms of EPA's key priorities, we're going to continue our commitment to sound science and developing goals, use all the tools we can, achieve a full range of implementation flexibility. If I can emphasize one thing to this group, I think there's an area that we have not spent collectively a lot of time talking about, and that is implementation flexibility. So if we develop a numeric criteria, then what are the paths forward in terms of implementing that criteria? How much time is available? What technologies are expected? What sorts of flexibilities are available? All of those are well worth discussing because, in fact, there is a lot of implementation flexibility, I think, that we can bring to this particular problem. Broader stakeholder collaboration. EPA continues to be concerned about both public health as well as aquatic health risks. Nutrient frameworks for joint action we think are essential. We aren't going to succeed without pulling point sources as well as non-point sources together. And finally, we are going to continue our support for developing numeric nutrient criteria based upon the best available science. So that is hope frames the conversation, leaves plenty of room for discussion and collaboration. Thank you very much.